Hello and welcome to the last session in the plenary session. Today, it's as this gentleman has said, it's a 360-degree debate on financial inclusion. Whose baby is it anyway? Is it the responsibility of the banking regulator, or it's the responsibility of corporate, and it's a part of the corporate social responsibility, or it's a part of social intermediation? In other words, who would bail the cat? 67 years after independence, we have, according to the World Bank report 2012 working paper, only 35% of India's adult population have access to formal banking services. Is that correct, Dipali? That's what it said. So next 1 hour or so, including audience interaction, if you are interested to ask questions, we'll discuss whose responsibility is this. Is this the central banking? Dipali is representing Reserve Bank of India. She's an executive director. Is it central bank's responsibility? Is it the state's responsibility? Or is it financial intermediaries like banks and microfinance institution? Should they go ahead and do this and sensing a business opportunity there? So without further adding to this and reeling out numbers and so on and so forth, let's get into straight into the debate. Dipali, lady first, you have the first one. Give us a sense. You have been claiming, Reserve Bank of India has been claiming, that you have been doing enough. You have already completed the first phase of your financial inclusion theme. You have launched the second phase. Many numbers you keep on reeling out from various conferences and all, but the ground reality is slightly different than what you claim. So could you tell us, where are we, and do you actually see it as your responsibility to push financial inclusion?
I have a few slides also, if I could show those to you, if someone has those. Is there someone who can? Yes.
Yeah.
So this would basically show you that the dominance in the Indian context is of the public sector banks. The second slide will show you, it will show you the entire outreach of the banking system. And why I say it is the Reserve Bank responsibility. It is the Reserve Bank responsibility because the Reserve Bank, through the agencies of all these bank branches, can achieve what an agency in the unorganized sector cannot, because there is a delivery mechanism in place. Moreover, it is a delivery mechanism over which we exercise strong macro policy control. Then can we have the next slide? Can someone show another, the next slide also? This just gives you the rural branch network of the commercial banks. This shows you how the rural bank network has expanded since we began the position. We began these financial inclusion plans, what you termed my first phase, why this has increased. But I will come to the broader question. I think someone can scroll and show the other slides also. This again is the urban bank network, the next slide. This is the composition of the rural branch network, and you can see this thin slice, the red slice, is the private sector banks. And then there is the regional rural banks, which by design are in the rural areas. The next slide, please. After this slide. Who's handling this? Yes, this is what I wanted to show you. The branch expansion and the banking outlets in the villages. You see, in the year 2009, when we began this process, we decided, 2005 actually, we mandated the basic savings bank deposit account. 2009, we did a stock taking of all that we had achieved. We found it wasn't as much as we wanted. And in earlier days, the RBI used to follow a policy that if you had four urban branches, you would necessarily get one urban branch if you had three rural branches. So we came back to that and we said 25% of the bank branches must be in underserved areas. Now, why am I batting on so much about banking when, to my right, of course, Mr. Ghosh is now going to be a banker, but there is Mr. Mahajan who heads the microfinance sector, and there's the unorganized sector, because there are four things which banks do which nobody else does. Microfinance is all very good. Microfinance is very good for capacity building, institution building, kind of financial literacy of the people, but it does not give everything under one roof. It essentially gives me a monoproduct offering of credit. And you can say the RBI is to be blamed because it doesn't allow deposit acceptance granted. And why do we not allow that? And why do we say banks are greater than anything else? Because the bank gives you the entire script of the play. Savings, credit, remittance, insurance, pensions, transactions are all possible at reasonable price because the cost of administration is factored into the bank. And then there's significant, the second thing is that up to 1 lakh, all the deposits, all your deposits with your friendly neighborhood bank are secure. So even if the bank goes bust, up to 1 lakh and poorer people have deposits up to 1 lakh, your deposits are secure. The third reason why I believe in banks is because I can trust them to do what they're told to do. And we are trying to tell them to push microfinance-like activities. That is, we say you give everybody who requires one a Kisan credit card. And the next slide will show you, if you can go to the next slide. This is just shows the bank branches. This shows you how the basic savings bank accounts have increased and how, you know, we decided that people were not coming in Dada and these were becoming dormant. So then we decided that just as you need to hook your customer, you must give an overdraft account. And we told the banks that unless you start offering services to people, you will not be able to get customers. And ultimately, we want you to have a business model and an effective delivery model. Now, one of the disappointments of financial inclusion has been that there are not enough products which have been crafted to the needs of the rural customer. Now, we have given a supply response. What I showed you was a supply response in terms of the number of bank branches opened. And there were several regulatory concessions, which the Reserve Bank made. For instance, you see, and this is something internationally, financial inclusion engages the regulator's attention. Because the regulator has to build an enabling environment for the creation of an ecosystem which links everybody to help the person at the last mile. So when I say internationally it engages attention, I draw your attention to the G20 group of countries which have a financial inclusion group which is called the Global Partnership for Financial Inclusion. Then you have the Financial Action Task Force, you have the CPSS, you have all these standard setting bodies, and they have significantly relaxed internationally the Know Your Customer norms. We have cloned that, we have argued with the Home Ministry, because what is the Home Ministry's concern in having a proliferation of accounts? The Prevention of Money Laundering Act and Anti-Money Laundering regulations kick in. So we first relaxed these KYC norms, and we said just a photograph self-certification will do. And the second thing which we relaxed was we allowed an agency model to come in. We allowed the banking correspondent or banking facilitator to be engaged. We enlarged the catchment area of this BC because we appreciated that a brick and mortar branch in all 6 lakh underbanked villages was not feasible. So in sum, what we have tried to do, and I saw you looking at your watch, is simply to create the environment which will allow the micro, the financial inclusion segment to grow, and as to whose baby it is, one segues into the other. The regulator creates the environment, the bank takes up the gauntlet, the social sector steps in with capability, capacity building, and links itself to the banking system, and the banking system innovates. And how has the banking system innovated in the last 10 years, as my senior colleague, Mr. Mahajan, an elder brother, was telling me, in the last 10 years, he has seen core banking solution, whereby you're a customer not of a branch, but of a bank. You've seen a revolution, even the regional rural banks and cooperative banks are on the core banking solution. You have immediate money payment transfer services. You have the National Payments Corporation of India. You have Aadhaar, which gives you a unique identity. And now you have Aadhaar, which enables an eKYC. So in sum, changes are taking place. So if you like Rip Van Winkle, step back 20 years and re-enter, there's a lot of change. If you view it incrementally, you feel that we are not doing enough. But the bottom line is very simple. It is something which needs doing. It is a commitment which we have to the people of the country. Because if there is not equity in economic growth, then there is no sustainability of that economic growth. So that's the message I leave you with.
Thank you, Dipali. You have done your homework well. And so essentially what you are saying is this, your job is the job of an enabler to create the right kind of ecosystem. And it's the banks who need to take the initiative. Yes, you have explained that how the number of rural branches over the past 5 years have gone up much more than what we had seen in the past 20 years before that, right? You have, yeah. You also spoke about the millions of no-frills accounts, so on and so forth. But do the numbers say actually the real story? Let us money, you are the part of a payment system. Is the regulated... Okay. So is that money? Is that could you? I think we can later we can distribute those.
Yes,
no, I print out. We can distribute those. So we can remove it from the screen and we can distribute this those letters. Whoever is interested, Dipali is always available to give it to you. Mani, tell us. You represent the payment system in some way. What do you see? Where is the lacuna? Who is not taking enough responsibility? And how do we sort this out?
Thank you. Am I audible? Okay. I come from basically the payment side of the business. While I agree with the madam, every infrastructure has been in place, and largely it has moved on from where it was in the 80s to in the 2014s. So, what's actually missing is basically, I basically just take the country as well as basically just anything that happens in the country is similar. We have very good policymakers. So we have OTI, Janopal, X, Y, Z, everything. But what we don't have an execution team. So the execution team basically anyway fails, and there is an inspection team, an audit team. So what we basically just step back in a financial sector is we always basically have a risk factor coming in front. So possibly just we go back, not basically execute the policy that has been done. What we have actually done in the whole space is just scratch the top. It's a lot more down. I possibly believe. Who is the beneficiary in this whole piece of financial inclusion? Apart from basically the consumers who are going to be there as the customers of the banking system, there are the future consumers for every industry. It is not only for banking, for the retail industry, for basically the services industry, which is going to come back, whether it is basically international retail shops or any other basically retail chain shops, Goldsmith, AXY, telecom, so on and so forth. Every other industry is going to be benefited because these financial institution customers today are the future consumers. They also tend to benefit. And what is their contribution to this? Nothing. The primary objective is there has to be some social responsibility from the corporates, including the beneficiary of the banking and financial system, and other corporates who think we are creating future generation of consumers. And that is the consumers who is going to use my services tomorrow and is going to pay for the services. Because of whom, there's a huge volume. Maybe I think, assume basically entire basically country using Flipkart, Snapdeal. What is Flipkart will be? That is what we have to do, which you have, that is the future basically just things that Flipkart has to invest, or Snapdeal has to invest. There are other basically interested bodies has to invest in those consumers. I possibly believe the future is still basically just far ahead. We have just basically scratched the top. And we have a long way to go. I appreciate basically the bank, Reserve Bank, the Central Bank of India, and other basically just bodies like IDRBT, NPCI, which has put the whole basically ecosystem. Imagine basically about few years back, we possibly just have to have a settlement and clearing about minimum four days. Stakeholders, primarily the beneficiaries, as far as I consider as the consumer beneficiaries, have not basically taken this one as. The second most important thing I possibly raise. Treating the consumers as equals. The financial inclusion customers have been taken as though that we are doing a charity to them. No. If you don't treat them with respect, as a guys who are a future consumers, so that tomorrow they become equal to you in terms of basically just asking for the rights as the financial services requirements, I think we are actually missing the point somewhere. We should possibly treat them as equals, treat them basically much more with respect and dignity, so that actually they are respected for what they are going to be in the future. Today, if you ask me, basically, just, you know, I stay in a place very near to here. The hotel population would be about 2,500 people. But the support staff for every house will be 4 people. So imagine, I think there is 1:4 ratio of support staff living. They just don't have any other financial services there. They borrow from the land, the house owner, they borrow from your driver, your basically mates, your ex, y, everybody borrow from them. And I think, which is where I think is we don't treat them with respect. We have to basically give them the services which they expect us to do, and we have to treat them at par with ourselves. Once that is there, possibly I think is in the whole, the growth path, I possibly believe, will go much faster than, which happens in advanced countries than what it is in India.
Yeah, thanks, Mani. So essentially what you are saying is this is the responsibility is lying with the service providers. We don't treat them as customers. We need to see the business opportunity there, and we need to nurture them, nourish them, and that's the way entire platform should work. Mahajan sir, you have been in this more than anybody else in this area of financial inclusion. You are a part of the committee, Dr. Rangarajan was the panel and all, and there you spoke about the state subsidy, right? You also run a local area bank, so you wear too many hats and all. So what is your take? Whose responsibility is the state? Is the regulator? Is it the part of the social intermediation? Or is it the part of the financial system?
So Dada, if you'd first let me paraphrase or slightly rephrase the title of today's topic. So instead of regulatory supervision, corporate inclusion and social intermediation, actually the situation is, Dipali, forgive me, it is regulatory intrusion, corporate collusion and social illusion.
That's good.
So in a sense, and the fourth actor in this is missing.
The state.
Which is the user.
Okay.
The state, I'm including by regulator, I mean both the state and the DFS, you know, who tried to intrude, you know, so rudely in 2012, if you remember. The fourth actor is the user who's missing. So as a result, what has happened is that we have ended up with a situation where instead of the best of all worlds, by the way, we get high marks for trying everything. But the combination that we've got is not necessarily perfect. Okay? Now, for example, the BC model, of which we are all so proud, was first launched in 2006.
That's the banking correspondent.
Yeah, the banking correspondent. The Khan Committee was 2005.
Yeah.
Now, it's taken us from 2006 to 2010 to first say anybody other than school teachers and retired army officers and, you know, cooperatives can be BCs. I mean, the most interested actors, which is the private sector, were allowed only in 2010. And within the private sector, the most interested actors, which is microfinance institutions, who deal with millions of these, are even today not allowed, although I believe there is some rethinking that's happening on that matter. And I hope, you know, sense prevails. So in a sense, it's like saying, yes, we're adopting a policy, but not really adopting it. You know, in the process, we've lost 6-7 years. And yes, 2,20,000 or 2,30,000 outlets were opened. But those outlets, if you see their usage ratio, the dormancy rate of bank accounts which were opened is 90%. Of the remaining, the usage rate is 3 transactions per annum. So is this financial inclusion? This is delusion of inclusion. So, by the way, I say this very sadly, and I say this without pointing fingers at anybody. Because, as I was saying in the speaker's room.
But you are looking most of the time at Dipali. So,
that's because. That's because she's sitting in the center.
Okay. Yes.
But what I'm saying is that we all together will have to solve it.
Okay.
So you know, it can't be by pointing fingers at each other. So, what is it that we need to first get correct? corrected. First is we must realize that nothing, no service can ever be delivered for free. If it can't be delivered for free, then someone has to pay for it. Who should be the most logical person to pay for it? He or she who benefits from it.
Correct.
Now, is it only the user who benefits from it? No. In this case, the provider also benefits from it, as Mani said, because in the long run, they are building a customer base. The state also benefits from it, as the famous McKinsey study showed that, you know, $30 billion would be saved if all government transfers happened electronically rather than through the old method. You know, so the state saves, the banking system gets new clients, the user saves, you know. So therefore, since all three of them benefit, they should all share. Quite frankly, the only outsider in this thing is the social. Who is social? Kaun hai? You know, so if you remove the social and get real, that is self-interested service providers like microfinance institutions, BC companies, technology companies, then they are part of the service providers, you know, and they benefit from the expanding market and they should also pay for it, part of it. So in other words, what I am saying is that we need, first of all, an honest to God sit down costing calculation. What is it going to cost to get every Indian citizen access to a secure, affordable, easy to access banking account? First, if it's going to cost, say, 27 rupees 50 paisa, what is reasonable for the user to pay, what is reasonable for the bank to bear, what is reasonable for the government to pay, what is reasonable for the technology and other service providers to pay? Right. Sure. And we should share it out, and we should roll it out till we reach 1.25 billion. So in my next intervention, I will...
So essentially you are saying that access to banking services is a fundamental right.
Yes. That
everybody, right? Everybody, you have here is a more, we have more mobile telephony than bank accounts.
Yeah.
You are saying that access to bank account is a fundamental right. 1.2 billion people should have access to bank account.
Yeah. I'm being very serious about it. In our constitution, Article 19B, right to livelihood is not mentioned. It's in Article 39. It's under the directive principles. But in a series of judgments, over the last three decades, the Supreme Court has said that the right to life includes the right to livelihood.
Sure, absolutely.
You know?
And you are saying that while...
And I'm saying livelihood today means access to the financial system.
And while Dipali is talking about a regulator who is creating an ecosystem and enabler, you are saying is an intrusive regulator, and you are saying it's an illusion of financial inclusion.
So,
very provocative statements. She will answer. She will answer you.
But I must say that when I use the word regulator, I don't mean only the RBI.
Okay.
I mean the entire system, including DFS.
Okay, fine. We'll come to that. But before that, we will hear Mr. C.S. Ghosh.
Yes.
First, congratulations.
Yes.
Those who do not know, he has, Reserve Bank of India has given two in-principle licenses to 25 license seekers for banks, and Bandhan is one of them. So, Mr. Ghosh, you have more than 5 million customers,
yes.
Right? More than 5 million customers. You have 6,000 odd crore book. And you have got the Reserve Bank stamp of approval. Essentially, you are a gold standard of what you have done in the financial inclusion scenario. Now, what Mani said is this, one needs to see this constituency as consumers. One needs to nurture. And so essentially, marrying this so-called CSR activities or financial inclusion with the business aspects making profit. And you seem to have done it quite well. Could you tell us how you have done it, and whose initiative is this? Have you got the right kind of push from the and support from the state, from the regulator, from the society, and how have you done it?
Thank you, Tomalda, and thank you to all of you to given this opportunity to sharing in here. Bandhan is a microcredit organization, you know, And we started in the 2001. We find out the gap of the society. Those are small enterprise, entrepreneur, and they have not any access to the formal financial services. They are fully depend on traditional moneylender, 1% per day interest paying to the moneylenders. So on the basis of traditional moneylender, any enterprise cannot be stands, and they will be not good viable on that. On the basis of that situation, we started how we can give the banking services to the people. Those are not accessing the banking services. And it is very tough when I started it to access the financial services from myself also. And of course, as a poor people are not that rich. And so that we take the money from bank and give to the poor people, and poor people again give me, and I return back to the bank. So this is a, some fact is there, the, there is a gap in there, what is their demand, and what is our financial institution supply, there is a big gap. And a very big market, one sense, and very big need of the poor people, they would like to get fund for their survival. And that way, second thing is that they are not thinking about the cost. They are thinking at the how simple way they would like to access it on that. And cost is not the factor, they have need the money. So we started this organization with a one product is a business loan, 1,000 to 3,000 rupees. Now is a 1,000 to 15,000 rupees, one product. And then simultaneously, you say that they developed the different types of social need of these people. When the business have been strengths, they have need in the sanitary latrine. So we are developed the health loan for sanitary latrine. This is not the business interest, it is an interest, it is a concessional rate. Second thing is that there is another social need of this poor family, send their children from government school to the English school, private school, because they also feel their children has needed a good education, means the quality education, not only the school going and coming on that, and quality is not there. So they would like to pay on that. This demand has come on the, from the community, and we learn from them, and again we have been given the small amount in the up to 5,000 rupees for children education. So in that way we are coming on these things, and we feel that this is from beginning, we will be first survive on the basis of this business model. If we not survive, we cannot be ensured the others' sustainability. So that our model have been developed from the day one, it is a financially viable. And if I, my model is a financial viable, of course the enterprise who are running, they also think about it in the financial viable. And charity is cannot be sustained in a long run. Charity may be the one time for need for disaster management, not in a entrepreneurship side on that. So in that way, we have come on that. Now we reached in the 22 states, and the 55 lakhs customer is a 1 month. We adding the 1,86,000 new customer to our services. So they are also coming now on that. Another factor have been worked on that. Total finance is a faith, that is a trust. And the first challenge we faced on that, the how we create the trust from the customer side. And when we have been start the dealing, and trust increased in the day by day. And so that every week, physically trust with our customer, every week, every customer, so that that we are build up this trust with the customer. And also we have been build up simultaneously trust with the, our bank. So if a bank will not funding, so we will be not served to these people. And bank also faith the trust on us, and then they will be also give the support to us, and we are supporting to the this level of the client. So other thing, you know that the the huge database is there, information about the customer level in the country perspective. But we feel that the who are our customer, there is a need to database of the manually. So when my staff has meet with the customer every week, they know everything of their family. And accordingly, they will make their proposal, how they support it to them. So that is also have been helped us to reach in this position. We'll give the thanks to the Reserve Bank of India to given that license to us to provide these services to the customer. Now we are giving the one service, that is the credit. When we become a bank, we are eligible to all banking services, all banking financial services to the customer or the, who are existing and who are living in the same community, we are eligible to go in. And it will be a very good sustainable model we are trying to running on that.
Thank you, Mr. Ghosh. Thank you for very lucidly explaining things. But essentially what you are saying that you are cashing on the inefficiency of banking system. Right, because the bankers could not reach, you are using bankers' money to give loans to others and keeping a spread. So essentially, and Dipali, that's that the buck stops at you because of your entire focus is on it's a bank-led model. You know, you will not allow the MFIs, as Mr. Mahajan says, to even become banking correspondents. So it's like that your approach is more as an obstructionist approach than an enabling approach. Could you explain to us?
No,
I know you have fiercely jotted down many points.
I have not fiercely jotted down. I was afraid that looking at Mr. Mahajan, whom I respect a lot, I may forget to say certain things. So I noted them down.
Quickly,
Okay. So yes, absolutely, I accept that it is the regulator's role to be the interventionist. It is my dharma to be an interventionist. Because my end need is customer protection. And I have to ensure the systemic stability is there, that no fly-by-night operators come in and walk off with your funds. So that is the first thing. As far as regulatory intervention, yes, you can even call it regulatory aggrandizement in the interest of overall customer protection. And it is not so very long ago when people were battering down the doors of the Reserve Bank, begging to be let in and begging to be regulated. When the Andhra crisis blew up, it took us 30 years to regulate interest rates or to come out with any guidelines on MFIs. Because we found that the profit motive, as in PROPHET, was unfortunately just a profit motive. And if it is a poorer person, as the one and only Dr. Chakravarti, my mentor, guide, guru, always says that what we want is for you to have compassion for poorer people. And if you have compassion for poorer people, you will see that they are not fleeced, but you must charge for the services. Because otherwise, you see, all of us who sit in this room feel that the poor are a category in inverted commas who do not have access to finance, do not have access to financial services, rubbish. Daryl Collins and several other people have shown that they have access, only it's at a much higher cost. When you want to send money, you walk into a bank, you remit the amount. When they want to send money, they find somebody from the village, and the amount of money which gets lost in the process, I mean, the person who takes it may renege, the person who takes it may charge very high for that service. So we have never said that it should be a free service. We have said that there should be a viable business model. And I would also like to tell you that there is a financial sector development council. We also have a financial inclusion advisory committee where we do have people like Mr. Mahajan, people who are senior people in civil society to help us to devise from the demand side. What do we do for financial literacy? Because until and unless we look at financial literacy, we are not able to ensure that there is a demand for products and services, which we then tell the banks should be crafted to the needs of the poorer people. I've already said that it is a disappointment that many more people have not come forward to craft services linked to the needs of the poor, but I do see that happening in days to come. I also see myself ring-fencing the system, and I also hope that regulatory aggrandizement, not just intrusion, will continue in the interests of systemic stability and consumer protection.
Thank you. Thank you. Dipali is very spirited defense because regulator's primary objective is to keep the systemic stability, right? That's the thing and all. Mani, you tell us, you heard her saying this, why the regulator is doing what it is doing and all. And you also said in the beginning that one needs to treat them as customers, nourish them, nurture them and that and all. But there's a viability gap. Right? I mean, which is why the banks are not going and MFIs are reaching out to them because this is a typical thing where angels fear to trade, that kind of situation also.
Yeah, if you didn't believe in microfinance, you wouldn't have given us the
correct, approach. Absolutely. So tell me, how do we, it's a chicken and egg situation, how do you actually start? How do you break the logjam and actually making where 80-90% of adult population having access to banking services instead of 35%? After so many decades of bank nationalization?
I think it's the people who follow the banking industry very well. After nationalization, I think it's what was basically the consumer population or the customer population that has basically just gone into the banking industry. And after financial inclusion, what is the consumer population that has gone into the banking industry? If you see basically the growth pattern, possibly that was more than what it is today.
In touch with the customer. And second thing, we established before giving the loan as a discipline in the group. And also, simultaneously, we also educated that how they are benefiting and if they repay it and how they will get the chance further and they can grow their business. That is the things we are educate. We say it is a financial inclusion, financial literacy. Before getting the loan, 2 weeks we have given the training on that discipline basis. And the second thing is that every week they are attend the group meeting and that is in compulsory. And when they attend the group meeting, we have also motivate them on that and build up the also discipline in their side. And in that way, they are feel that there is a one family with the all group members along with our staff. And faith have been developed with the customer. With the staff and staff also faith with them, and there is very much a transparent in there. Transparency means that any transaction have been done on the basis of group meeting, and all transparency is there. So openness is also helped us on that.
What is your percentage of bad assets?
Percentage of the bad asset more than 90 days, it is in 0.13%.
13 basis points. Remarkable. Thank you. Sir, Mr. Mahajan, you
but
are the last.
I can be
please,
at one point.
Please.
You have been given that the blame is the bank inefficient. I'm not saying on that. If you say that the foreign bank, if I like to open an account, they have need minimum 50,000 rupees. Hmm. If we come to the Indian bank, open the account, there is a 10, need 000. Also some amount on that. Hmm. So another segment of the people, those are living who has the 100 rupees, 200 rupees,
right,
or 500 rupees like to take, give the deposit, but where their
true,
opportunities.
True.
So we would like to give the services to that level, and of course is a small is always a pricing high, and because it's a small ticket, and that is also cost is high. So that microfinance institution is a bad name is in their charging high interest rate. Because there is no alternative on that.
So
one alternative is there when we take the deposit and there our cost of fund will be come down and we can be reduce the lending rate also.
Okay.
So this is in one package given the opportunities by RBI, which we can be reach in the another segment is a large number of people who
sure.
are unbanked and easily can be get the access of financial services with their deposit and credit, which can be help to the country to
sure.
increase the GDP.
Sure, Mr. Ghosh, I mean, best wishes for you because the biggest challenge for you will be to keep the culture. You said that 5.5 million, but it's a family. So once you become a bank, I think the biggest challenge will be to keep the culture intact. Mahajan Sahab, the last word is yours, and then I will take a few questions if you have any. Now, you did say that it's an equal responsibility. It has to be divided, the cost between the state, between the regulator, between the consumers and all. But historically, you have seen that it is a state which is responsible for decimating the microfinance institute in 2010, the Andhra Pradesh state law came up and all. And you could never, you yourself suffered, BASIC suffered hugely apart from SPS and all. So, wiser with the experience, could you tell us a roadmap for financial inclusion? Where you can actually will have a regulator which is really creating the right environment, and you have the state which is supportive, and you have the players like yours and Mr. Ghosh's who see them as consumers and not as a work of charity.
Yeah. So, actually, the organizers had two more chairs here, you know, and there are two very important actors who are missing.
Yeah, I wish there was a banker here.
Huh. By the way, I'm treating Dada now as a bank.
Okay.
So, I'm not treating him as an MFI.
Okay.
He's graduated MFI.
18 months
so,
before.
So, huh? he's about to be a bank.
Okay.
Microfinance institution, technology provider, regulator.
Okay. That's it.
But the two chairs which were missing was
state.
One was
state.
The government.
Yeah.
Specifically the finance ministry, specifically the Department of Financial Services, because that's the only place, apart from the high-level consultative committee, where all the regulators meet. I mean, there's the Financial Stability and Development Council, but it's still relatively new. So, you know, microcredit is only one part of what the poor need. They also need microinsurance. The nation's growing older. They need micro pensions. Of course, we need micro payments, micro remittances, et cetera, et cetera. The farmers need micro futures. So, in other words, there's a whole world of financial services, but with a ticket size below 1 lakh rupees on the average, which does not follow the laws of normal finance. Microfinance is as different from normal finance as quantum mechanics is different from Newtonian mechanics. Why? Because transaction costs are a significant part of the total cost. You know, when you're dealing with a transaction of 1 crore rupees, transaction cost is not even a basis point of the interest rate. But when you're dealing with a loan of, you know, 10,000 rupees and being collected in 50 equal installments, you know, transaction costs are important. And therefore, that has to be taken into account. Secondly, the nature of the client is very different. You know, both their awareness levels and their thing. But because they're illiterate doesn't mean that they're not wise. And therefore, the sixth chair, which was empty, 100%. Was for the user.
Okay.
You know, it's time that we brought the user in as a, to give his or her own voice to these discussions.
Absolutely.
And not use surrogates like Dada or myself, sure, to speak on their behalf.
Sure.
Really, by the way, I'm looking forward to retire fairly soon, you know, as soon as I can get out of CDR, etc.
Okay.
The only thing that I want to do now is to organize a union of financial sector consumers.
Okay.
A union, a consumers union, because that's the only way you can sort out the neglect.
Okay.
That's a good point.
You know, we as consumers will have to assert ourselves, and that is when everybody will you know, start treating us as worthy customers. So that's one. So two key points. One is take a composite or integrated view of the financial needs of the base of the pyramid.
Sure.
And therefore the outlets, the distribution channels, the regulation should not be siloed the way it is for the larger financial sector. It should be integrated. As soon as you come below 1 lakh, you should take a horizontal view rather than a vertical view. And the second is that all six actors have to sit together and plan and, you know, work together so that we achieve the goal of universal financial inclusion.
Thank you, Mr. Mahajan. Best of luck for your endeavor after retirement, and best of luck for getting out of CDR. Before we sum up, is there any question, one or two questions we can, there's a gentleman there. Yeah, just quickly, we have already run out of time. So just question, a couple of questions we'll take. maybe one or two. Yeah.
My question is for the entire panelist over there. I'm just referring to a recent cartoon that was published in a leading newspaper. Rahul Gandhi couldn't get an account in Amethi. RBI governor D. Subba Rao couldn't get a simple account in Hyderabad, where he was right now is based. Then how can we think of financial inclusion of a large sector of people who are still illiterate or who still fears to get into the banks? Okay. And there are many proven models where the bank has gone to the people, but why that doesn't has been replicated by the rest of the people. Only some microfinancial institutions are going towards the people, and why does the major part of the major banks whom we speak of, whom the people trust larger than the microfinancial institutions, are not reaching to the people?
Yeah, thank you, gentlemen. Dipali, this is your question.
I'll take that. You see, there are two conundrums which we have to confront. One, you need financial literacy. And that will enable people to graduate to a bank account. And the second is the access usage conundrum, which we've talked about, that if you have a bank account and yet you're not able to use it. So in both cases, the supply responses of a banking system, but the demand response has to come from financial capacity and financial capability building. And the two instances which you mentioned are both very high profile people. It may be that there may have been a minor glitch which they confronted, which was resolved. But in the case of very poor people, it's not a minor glitch, it's a major glitch. And the only way we can solve it is through financial education.
Thank you. We'll take one more question if you have anybody else there.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's the last question, then you'll sum up. Yeah.
There's one.
Well, okay. Congratulations to Sankalp for organizing such a beautiful team. I think all our giants sitting there, congratulations. I think RBI has been highly recommended by all the world bankers as an excellent body. But I think Mr. Mahajan brought out that in trying to be clean and not put the country in a problem, they are playing it too safe. And in the process, they are not very loose with the rules. So when they are very strict with the rules, you can't reach the common man. So now he has suggested that let the consumer come in, and if that table has six people, things will move forward. Now I just want to ask Mr. Mahajan, what will the sixth man do to make everybody there take a decision and take the risk to go to the common man?
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. Mr. Mahajan.
So first of all, the sixth man will be a woman.
Okay.
You know, and I mean, if I could persuade Mamata Di, for example, to represent, you know, or someone like that, you know. But basically, I think assertion, you know, is very important. There are certain other economies from where we can learn. Malaysia, for example, has a very strong consumers union. Britain has a magazine called WHICH, W-H-I-C-H. You know, a small adverse remark by WHICH can lead to a crash in the market share of the best brands. Now there are internet campaigns where, you know, through viral demarketing, you know, many brands have got, you know, have been censured and have been disciplined by consumers. So what I'm saying is that we, using today's technologies, we can come together as consumers. We are no longer atomized or powerless. We need to organize. And once we do that, and at the same time, we have to be reasonable. By the way, if we say, humko sab kuch free de do, loan ke baad maaf kar do, etc., etc., I'm not for that kind of a consumer union. Yeah. I'm for a consumer union which recognizes that every service has a cost. The cost has to be reasonable and affordable, but consumers eventually have to pay for it. You know? Okay. So that will be part of it.
Thank you, Mr. Mahajan. That brings us to the end of a rather exciting debate, as they call it, 360-degree debate on financial inclusion, whose baby is it anyway? I mean, this is one subject we could have gone on and on, but it has to end. We have already exceeded the time. So what are the key takeaways from this debate? One is this: financial inclusion does not only mean opening bank accounts. It has to be a package of all sorts of financial services which one needs to have. It is micro insurance, which is the mutual fund, which is both deposits and credit, so on and so forth. That's point number one. Point number two is this: this baby has multiple parents. That's what Mr. Mahajan said. State has to play its own role, not necessarily through not through loan waivers or subsidies, but actually real meaningful way. Regulator has to be real, creating the enabling situation and the ecosystem, which you have been trying hard and have been doing. The consumers have to come forward and bear a bit of a cost. And finally, what Manish said, and all of them agreed, and Mr. Ghosh has demonstrated through his 13-year journey, that you need to see this not as a charity, as a viable business. You need to marry the spread of financial services with the profit motive, right kind of profit motive. Not, you can't be too greedy, but at the same time, you need to keep your spread and make it business viable. So with this note, we come to the end, and please give this lady and the three gentlemen a big hand. Thank you. Thank you.